I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible.
Okay, I'd like to call the Board of Education special meeting for the public hearing budget to order. Please stand for the pledge. I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
First item on the agenda is the presentation of the superintendent's proposed 2020-2021 budget.
Sorry for the audience, if you haven't been here before, you know, you have to spin around in your seats to see the presentation tonight. It's a pleasure to talk to you about my proposed budget tonight. To begin, is just a caveat, which is true at this point in the process every year. This is the superintendent's proposed budget for the board's deliberation. And we really are truly somewhat early in our process. It's important for everybody to know that the board could make changes, additions and or deletions going forward from this point in the process. This is my proposal to the board. I'm going to be pretty brief tonight. I'm happy to hear any questions toward the end or comments for the board to consider. So first, as I was just saying, we are fairly early in the process, but this is what we've done to date. All budget owners, and by budget owners I mean a school principal or a program director, has been asked to prioritize all of their requests before coming forward. All the budget owners were asked to submit a strategic budget request, and this is our second year in a row doing this part of the process, and this part of the process is really designed to get every single budget owner thinking about enhancements, strategic enhancements. What would make their program or their school even better for the kids of Wolcott? We treat that part of the budget separately, so every budget owner met with the board and presented their strategic budget requests to the board so that everyone could have a full understanding of what was being proposed. Simultaneous to that, the business manager, Mr. Benson, and I were meeting with each budget owner to vet all their requests. And at that point, we're really making sure that they're not asking for something that's redundant, that is already being done at another school or that we've already purchased. And also to make sure that they're just upholding basic accounting procedures. They're putting things in the right line item with the right number, et cetera. After that process was done, Mr. Benson and I compiled the budget and presented it to the board for their consideration. And then just finishing up earlier this week, every budget owner and I presented to the full Board of Education explaining our budget requests. And really beginning tonight, earlier tonight at a workshop and continuing on from this point forward, the board will review and continue to deliberate on these budget proposals. And then, no later than April 1st, the Board of Education will transmit their budget request to Town Council for its consideration. As always, I have some key priorities, and these are relatively unchanged year over year. We always want to invest strategically in personnel, resources, and tools to support the work of our teachers. And we continue to pay particular attention to supporting the board's vision of the graduate, which the board adopted in 2017. We always study very closely class size. We always want to maintain a high level of service, not just in the classroom, but also for our special populations, such as special education, school counseling, and mental health. We always want to budget efficiently for our school facilities. As many of you have heard, we have aging facilities, which require a good amount of upkeep. And my personal responsibility, I believe, is to do this at a very high level of transparency so that everyone in the town can understand how their tax dollars are being spent. It's really some several points of pride here when I talk about some of the achievements over the last few years of our school district. The red line you see here is our math scores, and the blue line you see here are English language arts scores on the state test, all the grades combined. This is the SBAC test taken in grades 3 through 8. And these lines actually represent our rank in the state. So some years ago, in the 2014-15 school year, we ranked 89th in the state in math and 101st in the state in ELA. Every number up or down on this chart is a rank point. It's a district that we did better or more poorly than. And it's a big point of pride. It should be for the board and all of the staff and the parents in the district that we've improved 37 school districts. We've surpassed 37 school districts in mathematics and 47 school districts in ELA. In other words, these are towns that used to perform better than we on the state test. We now perform better than them. 37 school districts in math and 47 school districts in ELA. Should be a very, very strong point of pride for progress we've made in just 4 years of work. That same data now just shown as overall achievement. You can see that these graphs generally trend upwards, and again, lots of hard work by the board, teachers, administrators make these kinds of increases possible. The next few slides are really about the changing face of Wolcott. And for people who are very long, long time residents, they may not see these changes, but we certainly see them in the schools every day, most especially in our earliest grades, like kindergarten and first grade. So the top line, the red line, is the state average for poverty. Our measure of poverty are kids who get free or reduced price lunches. You can see the state average is trending right around the mid-30s, 37.3, 36.7. But you can see here, we have trended in just a 5-year trend from 20% of our kids to 23% of our kids who qualify as poor. In other words, receiving free or reduced price lunches. And you'll note that this data is somewhat old. The reason we're using 2017-18 data here is that's the most recently available from the state. So the state always lags a year and a half or so behind. The next year when I show you this, you'll see Wolcott's line continues to trend up. It's important to think about this data two different ways. On this slide, we're going to do the same for special ed. 3 percentage points doesn't sound like much. 3 percentage point change from 2020.2 to 23.2. But when you think of percentage of change, that's a 14% change. In other words, we have 14% more kids than we did, just looking at those kids alone, when you look at it that way. So 3 percentage points of change, but the quantity of those kids have increased by 14%. As I was saying, here in special education, we see the same type of trend, but we are much closer to the state average here. The most recent state number is 15%, and we are at 12.5%. But again, if you notice, just 5 years ago, we were at 9.3%, now at 12.5%. Again, that looks like about 4 percentage points of change, but it represents an extra third. We're increasing the number of special ed kids by basically a third of what it was. So two different ways to look at that. And certainly we know that special education population is a population on which we spend an additional amount of resources. And English learners, the board has heard a lot about this. And again, we know that this line here is going to continue to trend up. And the board made a very, very wise investment in investing for the current school year in a certified TESOL teacher. But we continue to see the changing face of Wolcott, increasing numbers of kids who come to us who need to be taught English. They come from non-English speaking homes. And that is an additional challenge requiring additional staffing for us. This is something that our members of town council and the board has seen me generate for a few years now. This is a statistic that I developed myself. It's basically looking at what every single district in the state spends per child, divided by what percent of kids are proficient. I call this ROI, return on investment. Some people call it bang for the buck. So we rank fourth in this statistic of every school statewide out of, and this statistic encompasses 166. It's something that the board and the staff should be very proud of. Doesn't mean we have the fourth best scores. It means we are the fourth best at taking a dollar and turning it into student learning or student achievement, in this case on the state test for reading. So it's something that I think every townsperson can take confidence in, that we are not a wasteful school district. Every dollar that we get, we work hard to turn it into student learning. Comparing investments in schools. So part of the reason we score so well on ROI is because we are relatively low on what we spend per child. So there's a few things going on here that I'll take a moment to explain. There's actually a lot of different points of information on this one screen. So of course this is a summary, I don't have time to list in this statistic 167 school districts, but every district is ranked. I spend some time to rank them out of per pupil spending, which is the standard way to look at what a school spends on its children. So for example, right now, the town of Sharon spends the most of any town in the state. They spend roughly $36,000 per child to operate their school system. Right now, Danbury spends the least of any. They spend just over $13,000 per child. For the most recently available data, which is approximately a year and a half old, Wolcott ranks 159 out of 167, with our per pupil spending being $14,664 per child. So we rank relatively low on this scale. We have for many, many years, certainly during my 5 years here, that has remained true. We've actually moved up a little bit. I believe in my first year here, we were 163. So we are moving up slightly, but again, I think the money is quite well spent. The right-hand column is what's called ANGLIC. And Mr. Benson will help me because I always get it wrong. I believe that stands for Annual Equalized Net Grand List Per Capita. Thank you. I got it right?
Average.
Thank you. What that basically is it's a town's grand list per capita. Their revenue for taxes divided by how many people live in that town. In short, it's a measure of how much the town has to spend, how rich the town is, how much tax revenue they have to spend, or their ability to pay, that's what we call it here, their ability to pay for their programs, including education, but certainly not limited to education. So on that, Wolcott ranks 125th in the state. So in other words, our ability to pay for education ranks 125th. What we actually pay for education ranks 159th. So when I prepare a budget, and I'm a taxpayer myself, of course, I want to make sure that anybody's taxes are going to be well spent and that we're not living above our means. That's my question. Are we asking for more than we should? So one way I ask myself that is, well, what would it take for us to kind of get to the middle? How far below the middle are we in this case? So if you look at the median spending, and this changes every year, but for the currently available data, the median spending town is Guilford. Guilford spends $17,960 per child in their school system. So I take a look and say, well, what's the difference there? So we are roughly $3,300 below that per child. So we spend approximately $3,300 per kid less than the state average per kid or the state median per kid. So just to ask myself that question, what I do is I take that number, that $3,300, and I multiply that by how many kids we have. So in other words, to bring the Wolcott schools budget up to the median spending in the state, we would need to add nearly $7 million to our budget. $6,900,000 would have to be added to bring us up to median. Now, our friends from the town council will be happy to know that we are not proposing a $6.9 million enhancement to our budget tonight. But that's just a perspective, asking ourselves, where do we sit with regard to median spending, average spending, more or less? Another way to think about that would be, are we matching our ability to pay? Are we spending less than our ability or more than our ability on education? So I ask myself that question as well. So looking, looking again at this column, the 125th level for our ANGLIC is, according to the state, is our ability to pay. So doing similar math, I look for who currently spends at the 125th level. Right now, that's Groton. So if I do similar math, if I look at Groton's number, subtract our number, and multiply the difference by how many kids we have, roughly 2,200 kids, we're about 3.5 million behind them. So in other words, if we spent at exactly the ability we have to pay, if we paid right at the 125th level, if we invested right at the 125th level, we'd require roughly a $3.5 million increase to our budget. And again, we're not asking for that tonight. Those would respectively be approximately 20% and approximately 9% additions to our budget. So that's just, there's a lot of, this slide is very dense, but it's important that we ask ourselves these questions to make sure that we are, in for lack of a better term, we're living within our means. And I know the board would agree, I very much believe that we are. So I have two slides here of program enhancements, things that I am proposing to enhance kids' experience in Wolcott Public Schools. I'm gonna go very quickly through these. I'm not gonna read them each to you. If you've got the handout that was on the side table over there, I believe these are on page 6. These were what are called strategic investments. So we, and some of these are quite low in cost, and others are much higher in cost. So we need to invest in science materials. We want to continue to improve the Alcott Library. Frisbee is proposing team building activities there, a continuation on their strategic projects from last year. Tyrrell is currently and will be again next year looking at changes to its master schedule. We want to make sure teachers are ready and confident for that change when that might happen 2 school years from now. We have reformatted, due to exceptionally high cost for some parents and families, we've reformatted the celebrations at the high school, and we want to support that to make it affordable for students who want to attend. We've arrived finally at a 1-to-1 ratio for our Chromebook devices. We have, except for grades K and 1 and a little bit in 2, we do have a computing device for every single student in the district. Our students don't take them home as they do in some districts, but so such an investment needs to be kept up to date. So we want to get in the year 2 of a 5-year restoration plan. So none of those items or devices are more than 5 years old. Similarly for projectors, like the one we're using here tonight, those need regular updating. And we had a very successful curriculum academy during the summer last year. We want to do that again. Other program enhancements that are proposed in the superintendent's budget, we want to continue and get much more serious about staff training and network security. We want to make sure that our data is backed up not only on-site but also off-site. We want to provide enhanced security at the high school and hire an additional security aide who can basically work a swing shift covering the lunch waves, but also providing support after school for school security. We're looking into a pay differential for some paraprofessionals. We've trained some of our paraprofessionals in a much more technical part of the job called behavior technician, and we are investigating that as a possible stipend for those extra skills, but that is yet to be negotiated. That contract with that bargaining group is currently in negotiations. We want to provide kids with more access to help for kids who are struggling in mathematics. And I'm proposing to add administrative support at Wakely Elementary School. Wakely, by the way, continues to grow. Wakely is at 391 students as of yesterday. So a summary of our major cost centers as proposed. As is true in any such budget, salary and wages are always our top line at approximately $22 million. Insurance and benefits, the next largest, operating costs, transportation, all the way down through capital improvements being the smallest wedge here. And as the board knows, and if you've seen my presentations before, I always show that as pie. And the yellow circle on the outside symbolizes just how little of the board's budget and the superintendent's budget is discretionary. So really, nearly everything within our budget. All 88.6% of this budget proposal is governed either by a collective bargaining agreement or another type of contract into which cost increases are already negotiated and approved. For example, our transportation contract with All Star Transportation is a 5-year contract, and increases in each year of that contract are already written into that contract. Ms. Cordova.
You skipped the pre-K. You didn't know the pre-K.
I apologize.
That's pretty, you know.
I did.
Yes.
It is extremely important. Thank you very much. So yes, I apologize. So the another proposal is to expand pre-kindergarten programming. We currently have 2 classrooms, and each of those 2 classrooms has an AM and a PM session. This proposal proposes to add a 3rd classroom with another AM and another PM session. Thank you. So overall cost changes. The administrative staff and I always really turn over every stone to look for potential cost savings. Salary and wages, again, this is almost completely negotiated, except for a very, very small number of our employees who are on independent contracts. So this increase of $843,000 at the salary line is in negotiated and approved contracts. Very notable here is a decrease, which is exceptionally rare among my colleagues when I speak to other superintendents, a decrease of $358,000 in the insurance line. We've had a very, very strong year with our self-insurance fund. This, Mr. Benson and I joke often, we'd love to take credit for that, but it just so happens that we had fewer big claims this year. There is also some important long-term planning that causes that, we believe, behind the scenes, both by the board and by administration, and that is we've moved more and more of our employees to the high deductible health care plans. So several years ago, when the board began negotiating contracts to say all new employees will not be on the PPO plan, but will be on the high deductible plan instead, we believe that's starting to bear some fruit here, and we're starting to see those savings as people become more engaged in what their health care costs. Operating costs are also down. Very shrewd financial planning by the board and by administration. We're very pleased to see that our investment in LED light bulbs continues to save us a lot of money on electricity. And that's really in the face of generation charges going up. So even though generation charges are going up, our projected expense on electricity goes down with lots of, again, investment in things like LED lighting and vigilance to make sure people aren't leaving their computers on overnight and simple things like that. Additionally, we're projecting a lower cost for fuel oil next year. Transportation, again, that's a negotiated increase. Special ed tuition, again, very rare among my colleagues, but for special ed tuition, outplacements to decrease by nearly 200,000 is rare. Some of that is left to chance, as the board knows and many townspeople know. And special ed tuition is, again, just for outplacements. If a child were to move from another town to Wolcott today, and that other town had assigned that child an outplacement, we would be basically immediately responsible for those costs. So there is some chance here, and we've had chance on our side, but it's also a lot of very hard work by our special ed administrators to constantly review every child's program and not assume that if they once needed an outplacement that they will continue to. So we're legally bound and morally bound to always look at a child's program to see if a child can be serviced appropriately here in Wolcott, and whenever possible we do so. Other things like instructional supplies, athletic supplies, office supplies are up very minimally. Equipment and technology is up somewhat substantially. This is a line that was heavily cut last year, so a lot of that is returning to previous levels, and also with the investment in the devices I spoke of earlier. And capital investments is up nominally. And on the right is kind of what that looks like visually. So the budget summary. We are currently operating in the current school year with a budget of $35.5 million. We are proposing an increase of $424,156. for a proposed budget of $35,948,187 for a budget increase percentage proposed of 1.19%. And again, there's a lot of hard work over many years that goes into this. For perspective, I have access to this data for the state, and currently there are 42 districts reporting, and currently the average superintendent's requested increase is 3.24%. So this budget proposal is substantially below the average. And with that, I'm happy to take any comments or questions from members of the audience.
I see a lot of investment in the reading education specialists and stuff like that in schools. Why no investment in the math specialists for the schools for interventions?
So that is actually one of my recommended increases or additions in programming. So that is right here. So what we currently have across our elementary schools is one part-time math interventionist per school. And then 3 years ago, the board added a fourth part-time interventionist. And at that time, our data was showing this should be shared between Wolcott and Wakely. Looking at our most recent data and also the growing size of Wakely, my proposal to the board is to give Wakely a full-time math interventionist. That meaning the one that's shared could now be shared between Wolcott and Frisbee. So not only would Wakely's access to math intervention go up, but the other two elementary schools, well, Wolcott would stay the same and Frisbee would go up.
Thank you.
My pleasure. Anything else I can answer at this point? Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, next item on the agenda is public comment. If anyone would like to address the board, they may do so at this time. And if you just say your name and address for the record, that would be great. Anyone?
I'll go. Well, I'll sign in first. So as most of you know, I'm back from last year. My name's Ed Hawthorne. I live at 53 Lower Drive. And I created a little group Valentine's Day, actually, of last year called Wolcott Education Funding First, which has now grown to 239 members. And I know a lot of you are members of that and follow along and things such as that. But we all believe that education funding should come first in the budget. And I see a lot of friendly faces in this room that believe exactly the same thing. This budget increase is minimal. Very, very minimal. So, I mean, if you could expand it further, you know, best as to what strategic points, as we like to point out, would be best. But investing in instruction, investing in bodies to put in the classroom to keep class sizes down or something, that is really a good investment because it directly relates to property values. The stronger the school system is, the more our property is worth, the more our taxes, tax rate can go down, and the more our homes are worth. So, I mean, to me, education is the most important thing, and properly funding it to ensure our children achieve their full potential is something that we should all be focused on. So I would ask you not only to, I guess, adopt the budget as proposed, but look for ways to increase it even minimally to just make the overall experience for our students better. But the pre-K, that's really awesome. My little one just started this year and she absolutely loves it. It is a much better experience than we had with my first child that went to a private preschool. So it's great that we're thinking about expanding that. I mean, early intervention in the pre-K could lead to higher test scores, and those scores can go even higher, and we can jump a few more towns in that. So that's a really good investment, and I'd ask if you are going to cut anything, do not cut that. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Anyone else? Okay, at this time, I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
Someone?
Mr. Gugliotti, is there a second? Second by Mr. D'Angelo. Is there any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you for coming.